the derivative is arguably one of the most significant inventions in human history. But unfortunately, we have not consolidated on the precise meaning of these notations, and even the word partial derivative means different things in different contexts. Currently, there are two most widely used conventions. The first one is introduced in multivariable calculus, where we use the word partial derivative as opposed to an ordinary derivative. And the second one is typically used in physics and engineering, where we use the word partial derivative as opposed to a total derivative. So, how are these two different? And the more important question is, why do these conventions exist and in what context are they useful for? In order to find the answer, I searched through various resources in both physics and mathematics, and found that both conventions really do have valid use cases. So, when should we apply each convention? Derivative of a single variable function, roughly speaking, is the slope of the tangent line at a point. And the partial derivative of a multivariable function is the slope along the direction of one of the variable while holding every other variable as constant. And for a simple case like this, there is no ambiguity. But once we have a more complicated dependence that would involve chain rule, the choice of convention becomes important. So let's begin with convention M, which is the way that is taught in the calculus curriculum. If y depends on x, which depends on t, we're interested in the rate at which y changes with respect to t, which is calculated using the chain rule. Now, if u is a function of x and y, and both x and y depend on t, then we use the multivariable chain rule to determine the rate at which u changes with respect to t. Notice how we use the partial derivative whenever there are multiple dependencies, but we use the ordinary derivative whenever there is a single variable dependence. For example, we use du dt since if we follow every arrow starting at u, it terminates on a single variable t. Now, let's throw in one more variable s. If we want to find the rate at which u changes with respect to t, then we now have to use the partial derivative instead of ordinary derivative since there are paths that do not end up at t. And this is in some sense consistent with the basic notion of what a partial derivative is since the variable s is being held constant. To sum it up, we use ordinary derivative for single variable and partial derivative for multivariable. In either case, the derivative is total, meaning we follow every arrow down to that variable. So we have this ridiculous oxymoron where the partial derivative is total. Now, as per the convention P, we use little d for total derivative and del for explicit partial derivative. In particular, this convention arose from situations like this, where u has an explicit dependence on t, as well as implicit dependence through x and y. In this convention, partial derivative simply is the explicit derivative with respect to each function argument, and the total derivative du dt is computed by following every chain from u to t. In this convention, we have a meaningful way to distinguish between direct dependence of t and every chain leading to t. Now, let's throw in a couple of variables that are independent from t. So u explicitly depends on 5 variables. But u still depends on t the same way, explicitly and through x and y, so the total derivative still has 3 terms. Now, the total derivative of u with respect to z and the partial derivative is the same since there's exactly one path from u to z. And similarly, dy dt is the same as del y del t. So the circled expression, we don't have to use partial derivative despite y depending on 2 variables, t and s. Now, how would convention M fit into this picture? Ordinary derivative du dt doesn't make sense, as u has terminal dependence on 3 variables. And the partial derivative serves the role of the total derivative, following every chain down to t. But we don't have a symbol for explicit partial derivative with respect to t. So convention M was not really designed for a scenario like this. Now, let's go back to an earlier scenario where we used the convention M. If we tackle this with convention P, then the partial derivative of u with respect to t is 0 since there is no explicit dependence. And the total derivative of u with respect to t is the derivative with chain rule, following every path down to t. Now, for each of these partial derivatives, the explicit derivative and the derivative with chain rule would be the same, so it is technically not wrong to replace all of them with total derivative, although the nuance that we're trying to convey would change. The way that I prefer is to use total derivative for the last factor in each term, and I will explain why later in this video. So far, convention P just seems like the better choice since it is able to handle more situations. In particular, it was able to handle cases where there is explicit dependence as well as implicit dependence. So, in what context is convention M ever useful for? Let f be a function of two variables x and y, defined by the formula x squared plus y squared. Then, the partial derivative with respect to each variable is 2x and 2y respectively. Now, suppose we want to do some calculus in a different coordinate system, say the polar coordinate. Then we can think of x and y each as a function of r and theta given by this convenient formula. Now, if we plug in r and theta into x and y, then we get r squared. This new function in terms of r and theta technically is a different function than f. So if you're being a formalist, you would want to give it a different label, say g. But from an applied perspective, they are practically the same function, just different coordinate description for the input. So we frequently abuse the notation and label this new function f. Now, the derivative of this new f with respect to r is 2r. And if we use the chain rule on the old f to find the derivative with respect to r, then the derivative should come out to the same value 2r, and it is left as an exercise for the reader. Anyway, the big picture is, we want to think of f as a function of some abstract description of two-dimensional space, and that function can have at least two concrete coordinate description. And we use the chain rule, or the total derivative, to translate between these two descriptions. And both of these are just different ways to describe two-dimensional space, so it doesn't make sense to use different symbols for partial derivatives with respect to each coordinate direction, despite using chain rule to translate between them. Take a look at this page from the textbook Partial Differential Equations by Walter Strauss, and notice how the partial derivative with chain rule is used as a tool to make change of variables. This is the back page appendix of the textbook Classical Mechanics by John Taylor, and it shows gradient, divergence, curl, and Laplacian in three most common coordinate system. Notice how the derivative with respect to each spatial direction is written in partial derivative. In David Griffith's textbook, Intro to Electrodynamics, he outlines the derivation of these vector calculus operators. And the partial derivative with chain rule is used to translate these differential operators from one coordinate system to another. Now, in what context is convention P useful for? Of course, we have systems where we need to distinguish explicit dependence and total dependence. But there is use case even in an elementary scenario where f is simply a function of two variables. Now, let's formally define the differential or exterior derivative of the function f, which is the sum of partial derivatives of each input variable times the differential of each variable. Now, what does this geometrically mean? Each partial derivative represents the slope along each variable's direction. And using those two partial derivatives, we can create the tangent plane at any chosen point. df is the linear approximation of how much the function f changes. And f would change more if either the tangent slopes are bigger, or if we increase the step size dx or dy. But in practice, we don't want dx or dy to get too big. For example, if we want to find the exact change in f as we vary x and y, we want to make dx and dy extremely small, then accumulate those small linear changes in f. In short, these differentials are objects that are begging to be integrated rather than being standalone objects. Now, I'm going to commit an act of barbarity and divide both sides by dx. And this is the algorithmic definition of the total derivative of f with respect to x. Dx over dx is 1, and dy over dx is 0 since y is independent of x. So the total and the partial derivative are the same. So this indeed shows that this algorithmic notion of total derivative is equivalent to the derivative we found using chain rule. So convention P is very compatible with the notion of differentials. Now, suppose there is a time parameterized curve in two-dimensional space. Then x and y each are function of t. And the time derivative of x and y would represent the velocity vector at a given point. Then how much the function f changes with respect to time is df over dt. Now, let's multiply both sides by dt. These two equalities are different versions of the gradient theorem or the fundamental theorem of line integrals. So the convention P plays really nicely with the notion of differentials and line integrals. We have been doing similar things in calculus of single variables. For example, if we have a separable equation, we could abuse the notation a bit and multiply both sides by dt. Now, let's try striking this earlier problem with this new notion of total derivative. The total derivative du over dt is the explicit partial derivative with respect to each of the 5 arguments, times the total derivative of those argument variables with respect to t. Since z and s are independent with respect to t, last two terms would disappear. And dt over dt equals 1. So this notion of total derivative analogous to the differentials really is the same as the derivative with chain rule. Now, this begs the question, what is the differential of u? We can start with the naive definition, then simplify from here. We want to condense this as much as possible and remove all the intermediate variables. X depends only on t, so dx is equal to the derivative of x with respect to t times dt. And dy would have two terms, since y depends on both t and s. Now, the last step is to rearrange and write this as a linear combination of differentials of terminal variables. Notice how the coefficient for each differential is the total derivative. For example, dt gets 3 contributions, directly and indirectly from x and y, which is precisely the total derivative du over dt. Du over dz is same as the partial derivative, and du over ds gets 2 contributions. So the differential can be written as a sum of all the total derivative with respect to all the terminal variables times their differentials. Now, as a word of warning, if we treat total derivative like fraction, this is 3 times du, so we end up getting that du is equal to 3 times du if we treat derivatives like fractions. But this does tell us that there is 3 degrees of freedom in the dependence chain. Now, the differential du, if we want to be pedantic, we can call it the total differential. And it truly is an appropriate name since it is a quantity for the total change in u. We might be interested in how much u changes with respect to t while holding other variables constant, which is the partial differential. But we have a problem of differentiating between the explicit partial differential and the total partial differential. In my last video, I argued in favor of having different symbols for explicit partial derivative and the total partial derivative. And this is an example where that would be extremely useful. And using this alternative convention, we can avoid 1 equals 3 because of improper abuse of notation. So, we looked at two main conventions where partial derivative could mean explicit derivative or derivative with chain rule, and in what context each convention is used in practice. The reason I call them convention M and convention P is because they're used primarily in mathematics and physics community respectively. Let's take a look at an example where both conventions fall short. Suppose you have a solid circular rim, and you fill the interior with some elastic sheet like a soap bubble or a trampoline. If there are no external forces acting on the sheet, then the sheet would be flat since that would be the configuration that would minimize the potential energy. And if there is gravitational force acting on it, it would probably hang down with radial symmetry. And we can apply all sorts of non-uniform force on this surface, like placing many smaller objects on the trampoline. Let's define the function u to be the height, which is a function of two spatial variables. Now, in order to find what u is from a given configuration of force, we need to minimize the total potential energy. And we can represent the energy density, which we will call the Lagrangian, as a function of 5 arguments. And ux and uy represent the derivative of u with respect to x and y respectively. Then, the total energy would be the integral of the Lagrangian over the region. Let's take a look at the most well-studied example. If the quantity that we're trying to minimize is the total surface area, then the Lagrangian simply is the integrand under the usual surface integral, which has explicit dependence on the partial derivatives of u. In any case, We're typically interested in minimizing the value of this integral, whether it's the total potential energy or total surface area or whatever else. And we want to find the function u that minimizes this integral. This is one of my favorite theorems in all of mathematics. Suppose that this integral actually has a minimum. Then there is an equation that would minimize this integral no matter what the Lagrangian is. And this is the multivariable version of the Euler-Lagrange equation. I wrote it down in the form that you would find in the mathematics textbook, so we are using convention M here. So let's see how this plays out with this random Lagrangian of no physical significance. Let's just compute one of the term to see how we take the derivative. First, we want to find the derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to ux. For the first term, we treat x like a constant and we use the power rule. And the second term is independent of ux. And as for the last term, we treat u squared like a constant and take the power rule. So we technically took a derivative with chain rule, but effectively took an explicit derivative because there was only one arrow from L to ux. Now let's take the derivative of this with respect to x. This time, we're taking an actual total derivative down to x. So we have to apply chain rule, and we are treating only y like a constant. For the first term, we have to use the product rule, so we get 2x times the derivative of ux, which is the second derivative of u, plus the other piece of the product rule. And as for the other term, we use the chain rule, so we have 2u times the derivative of u. Once you compute all the other derivatives in the equation, then simplify it. Then the Euler-Lagrange equation simplifies to this second-order partial differential equation, which you would have to solve in order to get what the function u is. The process of deriving the specific partial differential equation from the Euler-Lagrange equation isn't too bad. It simply is a calculus exercise. But the Euler-Lagrange equation as it is written have some room for liberal interpretation, unless you know the context. If I was studying for an exam for a class I have been ditching and see this equation for the first time without prior knowledge, I could easily take the wrong kind of partial derivative, especially since there are both explicit and implicit dependence on x and y. Now, if we use the convention P here, the equation has more clarity and it serves better as an instruction manual, but it collides with the very context that this equation is studied, which is the study of partial differential equations. To start off with my favorite example, if we want to minimize the total electrostatic energy in three-dimensional space, the Lagrangian would be the energy density at each point, which depends only on the electric field. And it can be expressed in terms of the derivatives of the electrostatic potential, or more commonly called the voltage with respect to a choice of ground as our gauge. Now, applying the Euler-Lagrange equation to minimize the total energy, we get the most famous partial differential equation, called the Laplace's equation. But I purposely left it in the intermediate step to demonstrate that the partial derivative as used in convention P is not the same usage of the word partial in partial differential equations. And just to be edgy, we can totally write an ordinary differential equation, like the Hooke's law, with partial derivatives as in convention P. So the very language used in convention P has room for confusion with the common usage of the word partial. As an undergrad student getting a double major in math and physics, I found it very confusing and none of my classes properly introduced the difference. This is more or less like the stupid viral problem circulating on social media. We are taught in school that multiplication and division take same level of precedence. But in practice, it's very common to follow an unwritten rule to treat multiplication by juxtaposition as a single term. And whichever rule you choose to follow, someone out there will get triggered by your choice and start a meaningless argument. So in this video, we have demonstrated that both conventions have some shortcomings. If we instead use the alternative convention to differentiate explicit derivative and the partial derivative with chain rule, then all of the problems that we have encountered in this video would be solved. And we can use this symbol for the ordinary total derivative. So it agrees with the notion of total differential as we have seen earlier.